Let's consider that this is an equilateral triangle with side R. Okay. And the problem is given as three charges are placed. Three positive charges are placed at the three corners of this equilateral triangle. Now, another charge that is also positive is placed at the centroid. You know that the concept of centroid, the centroid is nothing but the point of concurrence of three medians. And the centroid is normally represented by G. If you take A, B, C as the coordinates of the vertices, then the distance from the centroid to each vertex remains same. That's what you have studied in your mathematics. So, if I say that this is A, this is B, this is C, this is G, then AG, BG and CG, the distances are same. Now, in the very beginning, we have to calculate the force due to the charge kept at A. What should be the value here? Here I kept all Q's only. By 4 pi epsilon naught. Here we cannot write R square because R is indicating this distance, that is side of the triangle. So let us consider some other, let us say, with the lattice itself AG square. And as these two are positive, it will be rippled. So the direction will be along A to G unit vector. I hope this is clear. This is the force due to the charge placed at A. So this is one force. Next, similarly, the second force, again it is same, all the things are same, only the variable is BG square, and then BG is the unit vector. That means this will ripple and then it goes in this direction. Now, if the force due to the charge kept at C, that is again Q by 4 pi epsilon naught CG square, and it is along the CG unit vector. So if I consider this is A, this is B, this is C, now this would be rippled in this direction. Now you see, I'll write parallel vectors here. One is vertically downwards, the other one is, this is parallel to this, the other one is this. And look at this expressions. AG is equal to BG is equal to CG. As the centroid is the equidistant from all the vertices of equilateral triangle. Therefore, this part, Q square by 4 pi epsilon naught, this part is same. That means all the three forces having the same magnitude. But what is the difference? The difference comes only in the direction. So now, if I remove this one, you have to resolve these components. Suppose if it is here, what should be this angle? If you observe that this, it is parallel to this one. So this is 30 degrees because total angle is 60. So this is 30.
then I can write this as F cos 30 and upward force as F sin 30. Did you get this point? Now here, this is in this direction. Again, this is 30, therefore this must be F cos 30. One more component of this vector will be upward, that is again F sin 30. So I'll write separately here for your understanding. So this is F cos 30, this is F sin 30. Here this is F sin 30 and this is F cos 30. Yesterday I told you that how to find the net force on any charge, you have to take all the x components together, add them, but you must pay attention towards its sign. If it is along the positive x-axis, you must take it as positive. If it is along the negative axis, then you have to take negative. So in that way, this I can cancel this F cos 30 because it is along positive I. And this F cos 30 is negative I. So I can cancel these two. Now these two are in the positive direction of y-axis. We know that sin 30 is half. This sin 30 is half. This is F by 2. This is F by 2. The net upward force is 2 times F by 2. Now, one more force is acting on it. That is nothing but due to this charge. So, this will be in this direction. That's what I have written here. So here, as it is in the negative y direction, I need not resolve it. I can simply write the value F, because magnitude wise all the forces are same. Now the upward force is F, the downward force is also F, therefore they cancel each other and final net force will be zero. This F net is zero is valid not only to this equilateral triangle, for any regular polygon. If the object is put at the center, then without calculating all these things, you can simply say that the net force is zero, provided these charges are of the same magnitude. If in place of plus Q, had I put 2Q, then certainly the answer would be different. But if all the charges are same, then the forces experienced because of symmetry, we can say that the net force is zero. I hope that this is clear for you. Now, next, let us do one more problem for square. What can you do? Suppose on the square, if all charges are same, Q, 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 if I put a small q here, what is the, and if I say that the side of the square is A, what is the value of the force acting on Q due to all these four charges? So we know that due to this it ripples in this direction, due to this it ripples in this direction. These two are equal and opposite, they cancel each other. Similarly, it ripples and it ripples in this direction. These two forces are equal and cancel, equal and opposite, therefore they cancel each other. Finally, you will get zero. So like this, you must analyze the vectors and then you have to see, and then suppose if it is not equal charges, then you have to take the you have to resolve the vectors and add all the y vectors and all the x vectors, and finally you have to take square root of fx square plus fy square, then to get the magnitude of it. Then how do you get the direction in that case? Suppose we know fx, this entire fx forces has turned out to be 3, let's suppose. Then entire sigma fx, okay, this sigma fy is turned out to be 4 newtons, just for sake of example. Then what you can say, the net force, resultant force is 3 square plus 4 square. That is fine. So 25 and under root 25 is 5 newtons. Okay. Now how do you find the direction? So to find the direction, one is x-axis, the other one is y-axis. So the resultant will be somewhere here. I can draw one parallel vector here and I can say that this is theta and this is my y components, adding all y components together, and this is adding all components of x. Therefore, I can write tan theta as 4 by 3 and theta is equal to tan inverse 4 by 3 with respect to where theta is the angle between the resultant force and x-axis. If you want to calculate with respect to y-axis, it is 90 minus theta. In that case, 3 by 4 will be the answer. So in this way, you can find out the resultant magnitude, at the same time, the direction of the force acting on any given charge. Now, let's do one more problem so that you will be thorough. Now, this is, question is same. I have not put any charge in between. Only the thing is, you have to find out the force on this. This is second charge. I considered this is first charge, this is third charge. What is the net force acting on second charge? What we have to do? We have to take the force due to this one. What it is given? It is minus Q. And here it is plus Q. And here also it's plus Q. Because of this, it is attracted towards this one. Okay. Now, because of this, it is rippling. The forces are same. Why same? Because so far as force is concerned, magnitude is concerned, F is equal to Q by 4 pi epsilon naught A square. In both the two cases, it is same. But when we talk about the directions, one is here in this direction, the other one is here. So this is also F, this is also F. Either you can resolve the components or directly we can go for the answer that we got in parallelogram law of forces. What we got, F resultant is equal to F net is equal to If you remember the formula, p square plus q square plus 2pq cos alpha. So f square plus f square plus 2f cos 120.
So you must know what is cos 120.
So here
cos 120 can be written as cos 90 plus 30, and as in second quadrant the cos is negative, so sin 30 it becomes
f square plus f square, that is 2f square. This is also 2f square, so I can take 2f square common, and here 1 and here cos 120. So cos 120, you are all mathematics students, of course I don't need to explain. So cos 120 can be written as cos 90 plus 30, then it becomes minus sin 30, where sin 30 is half, this is minus half, because cos in second quadrant is negative. So therefore 1 minus half, half, half of will be cancelled, and final answer will be f.
Again, if you want to say the answer along with the direction, it is f is
like this, because if you take the parallelogram, drawing one parallel line to this, another parallel line to this, the diagonal will represent the resultant force.
So you can find out tan theta is equal to fx by fy by fx, that also we can write. In either way, you must get the same answer. So in this problem, there are
two spheres. These are insulating threads. This also. Now these two are given same charge. So yesterday we have done one experiment with this one. So if I give the same charge, what was happening? The two were moving away from this one. So then, and they are static at that position as long as that influence of the charge is there. So let us do just once. See, the two are having some distance and they are constant. Okay, they are under the equilibrium. So here this question is also the same. Now when I removed that, the angle is becoming zero. Now the question here, there are two insulating threads and then two small balls are hanged, and those two balls masses are given m, identical balls, and we have given identical charges on them. This is q and this is also q. Now what should be the charge if the distance at the equilibrium is x units? I'll repeat, you just see the question closely. Take two balls, these two balls are of masses m, and then identical balls, and then we have given identical charges to them, then the ripple, and after rippling they are maintaining the same positions. Now this system is under equilibrium. Now you have to find out the value of q so that they are under the equilibrium. And here what are the things given? The length of the thread is l, so effective length, that is it is from center of this bob. Now effective length is l is given, and this distance at the equilibrium, it is x distance apart. Now you have to find out the value of q in terms of l, theta, and then x. So for this, what you have to do, you have to see what kind of forces, how many forces are acting on it. This is theta. So M is there, therefore there must be some gravitational force because of its weight. So that is mg. Apart from mg, as they are hanging with the help of threads, tension must be acting in the along the thread. So let us write the tension in components. So let's write this is, if it is theta, it should be theta because alternate interior angles. Therefore, this I can write it as t cos theta. Now, you can write this as t sin theta. Now here, this is plus Q charge and this is plus Q charge. So there should be one electric force because of which the system is under equilibrium. So that electric force is along this direction. Let me put these all forces, the system is under equilibrium. So when we call a system is under equilibrium, when the sigma fx is 0 and sigma fy is 0 and the sigma torque must also be 0. So here now there are two components along y axis. One is t cos theta, the other one is mg. So I can write those two must be same. So t cos theta should be equal to mg. Now electrostatic force must be equal to t sin theta. Now I do not know the value of t. So let me eliminate t by dividing this by this. So if I adjust this t sin theta as Fe, so and I divide this by this, if I take this as first equation, this is second equation, so I'll divide 2 by 1, so that t will be cancelled, sin theta by cos theta will come, which is tan theta, which is equal to Fe by mg. I hope that this is clear for you. We have taken all the forces acting on the charge. So that ball. So one is mg because of weight. Second one, tension. We have resolved tension, t cos theta and t sin theta. And one more force acting, that is electrostatic force of repulsion. That is Fe. So as it is under the equilibrium, we can equate the forces. Now by equating forces, we got like this, and then Fe must be equal to mg tan theta. Okay, now what is Fe? Q1, Q2, here both are identical charges, therefore Q square by 4 pi epsilon naught R square. How much it is? X square. This is all equal to mg tan theta. Our aim is to get the value of q. So this is q, this is q. Therefore q square is equal to this is mg. Actually I wanted to put square root, but it's q square is equal to mg tan theta 4 pi epsilon naught x square. Okay, now Q is equal to square root of mg tan theta 4 pi epsilon naught x square. Now you can write tan theta also in terms of L and X. What is tan theta? Suppose if you take this is theta. No, 1 minute. So if you consider that this is theta, this is X by 2. Sine theta is equal to perpendicular by hypotenuse. So sine theta, and this you can write it as L square minus X square by 4 under root. This is L, this is X by 2, so I can write. So now I can find out the value. Tan theta is equal to perpendicular by base. So X by 2 by 4 L square minus X square by 4, and you can simplify the answer. This simplification part is easy. Once you understand these two equations, writing of two equations is only physics. The rest of the thing is maths. So to write these two equations, you must have a thorough understanding of Coulomb's law of attraction or repulsion. At the same time, you must also know the resolution of vectors. And you must know that what are the different types of forces that are acting on the charges or balls. Okay, so electrostatic force of attraction, tension, and then tension is resolved because tension is not known to us. So better resolve that thing and cancel it out, and then we'll get one equation. If the numerical values are given, you can put up the values in this equation and you can find out the value of it. So this is all about different problems that I wanted to discuss so far as Coulomb's law is concerned. Now we have to move for the next topic. So on the other day, I have explained forces, electrostatic forces. Now again, let us get back to the electrostatic forces to introduce another quantity. What it is? So here, first I'll rub the straw with the silk, the same old experiment, and I'll keep this at one particular place. Then you will see that it is attracting these pitballs. Okay, now I remove these pitballs. Would you say there is nothing? So there must be something. This, and if I remove this one, you cannot say nothing is there in this vicinity. There should be something. That something is only known as electric field. So now the new concept we have to talk about is electric field. So here, if you take this as the origin and we place some positive charge here, and if you place another positive charge, so this charge, let me name it as Q, this charge, let me name it as small q. Now, what is the force experiencing by this on this one? Because both are positive, I took. So therefore, it is repulsion. So let it be named as P. This is O. I can write F, the force is equal to Q by 4 pi epsilon naught OP square, and it is along OP. So this is the force. There is nothing new in it. Now, how do I define the electric field? If this force, if I transfer this Q to this side, then we get a quantity F by Q, which is equal to Q by 4 pi epsilon naught OP square, and it is. This left side quantity is specially named as E, the electric field. So electric field is nothing but force per unit charge, and the direction of the electric field is also in the direction of force. So electric field is equal to force per unit charge. Now if I substitute this Q to be 1, what does it mean? In place of this Q charge, I am placing one unit charge, one unit positive charge. Then what happens? These two are equal. So you can you can define electric field as the force experienced by any charge on one unit charge placed at one particular distance. It gives us the electric field at P. Suppose if I wanted to know the electric field here, I have to keep again plus one charge here, okay, and then I have to see how much force is experiencing. So how much here? Let's consider that this is R1. Let this be R2. So in this case, what should be the answer? Electric field is equal to force, that is Q into 1, because unit charge we placed, by 4 pi epsilon naught. Let this be some P dash. So O P dash square, and it is O P dash unit vector. Now if you observe this one and this one, what is the difference? Q is same, Q is there in both the two. 4 pi epsilon naught is also associated with the both the two, because the medium in between these two is vacuum only. Only that it depends on distance. So electric field is purely depending on distance. It does not depend on how much charge we place there. Why? Because anyway, ultimately we are dividing by that charge. It may be 100,000, whatever it may be, finally F by Q we are taking. So in this expression, if you divide by this expression by Q, that Q will be cancelled. So we can write electric field as the force experienced by the charge when it is kept at one particular distance. So this is depending, is a function of R alone. If you take Q is equal to 1, then ER and FR will remain same. So if you want to calculate, if you know electric field and you wanted to calculate force on it, simply you take Q times ER. So electric field is what? Electric field is nothing but force experienced by a charge when one unit charge is placed at a distance, R distance, R units away from it. So that electric field and electric force remain same. So what should be the SI unit of electric field? Because it is Newton, F Newton, and this is Coulomb. So Newton per Coulomb is the SI unit of it. So we can define, because now it is a new physical quantity we have come across. So first of all, you have to define it. So how do we define electric field? Is nothing but the space covered by the influence of any charge. It is the space covered by the influence of any charge placed at one particular point. So this field is up to infinity. At infinity only, it becomes zero. Actually, when the distance is increased, the electric field is gradually reduced. Why? Because the formula says that E is equal to, E is a function of R. That's why I'm writing all the time R. So Q by 4 pi epsilon naught r square. If I take only magnitude, this is inversely proportional to r square. So when the distance is increased, the electric field is decreased. That means the influence of the charge on the unit charge placed at that particular point will be reduced. So now we will write the definition. If I say that we have placed one big charge Q here and I place another charge here, this is small q. Now mathematical definition says limit, let it be q naught or q. So limit q naught tends to 0. What we have to write here? How do we define force per q naught is only electric field. Now you must get a doubt here. What should be that? How q naught can be 0? How q naught tends to 0? Yesterday we talked about the quantization of charges. That is, q should always be in the integral multiples of ne. So it, the least value of the charge that we can acquire is minus 1e or plus 1e. Okay, in the positive side plus 1e, in the negative side it is minus 1e. But writing q naught tends to 0 means, suppose if this is q and if I place some bigger charge here in place of small charge, then what happens? It disturbs this one. So our aim is to see that it should not be disturbed. Therefore, to make it this as small, we are writing q naught tends to 0. Now the thing is, here if this is here and this is small charge, then this is called source charge. And this is called test charge, because we wanted to test how much force is being experienced on it. That we wanted to see. So test charge should not influence or should not disturb the source charge. So to make it, to make the source charge bigger, to raise the importance of source charge, we have written q naught tends to 0. In fact, q naught will never be 0. Either it is, if you take the number line, plus e, 1e, or minus 1e. Now, electric field. How can you visualize the electric field? When I introduce the lesson, I have taken the help of one plasma ball. This is the plasma ball I have shown. Let me switch off my lights. Now, how do we test that this is giving the electric field, or this creates electric field for us? Let me switch off the sound. So now I took this neon tube. So now when I take this neon tube, now let me adjust the camera so that I can place this neon bulb. Now you are all able to see some light. I did not touch. So this is touching, and I did not touch. I simply placed the neon tube just above the plasma ball. So if I increase the distance, then the brightness of this is getting decreased. If I see, now here at this portion, at this portion, as long as, suppose if I am touching, then it's coming. Otherwise, see, now I'll bring this into the influence of it. Now, here the brightness is increased. Now, so suppose if I keep this neon bulb, very far off, you won't observe any light in it. You see, you can see now. So in this portion, there is no light because it's, now if I keep very nearer to it, you can see the neon bulb glow at this portion also. Now it is not glow. What I wanted to tell you is the electric field is depending on the distance. The plasma ball here. And then I put the neon bulb here. When I keep the neon bulb very close to it, then I can see the brightness of the bulb, which is more. When I move this neon bulb far off from this one, the brightness is getting reduced. So it clearly tells us from the center, if the distance is increased, the electric field is reduced. So E is inversely proportional to R square. Now you are coming across several fields. Now let me tell you with one more field. It is also a simple experiment. Suppose you are exactly sleeping under the fan, you will get more air. Suppose field can be visualized with the help of the plasma ball or with the help of any charged straw. This is not the model of corona, this is the model of electric field. So suppose if it is the charge, I place some matchsticks over it, then this electric field is continuously decreasing when the distance is increased. So electric field is not constant. Somebody is asking whether it is a constant. No, electric field is varying with the distance. That's what I have written. E is inversely proportional to R square. Even the force is also inversely proportional to R square. At infinity only, it becomes zero. Now, electric field is established in 3D wise, not two-dimensional. It's not along a particular line. So that's why I made this model. In this, electric field, these lines are representing this electric field lines. Okay, so this electric field is a 3D phenomena. That means here also you will see the electric field, here also you will see the electric field, here also. So now as the distance from the center, the points that I have shown are same. Therefore, electric field must also be same in magnitude. But suppose at this particular point, the electric field vector like this, and at this particular point, the electric field vector is in this direction. At this point, it is in this direction. Now, we know that the locus of all the points, not on the 2D, in 3D, the locus of all the points, we distant with respect to a particular point is sphere. Okay, so electric field for a point charge is spherical symmetrical.